Hello and welcome to video lecture in sociology. Today we are going to discuss chapter 5 titled as Change and Development in Industrial Society from your textbook Social Change and Development in India. This chapter is divided into 4 parts. So far we have discussed about nature and features of industrial societies and emergence of industrial society after industrial revolution in Europe. Today in this lecture we will discuss about process of industrialization in India. Industrial society refers to a society that uses technology for mass production in factories and it has a complex division of labor. Industrial societies, as you know, developed in the West with industrial revolution and they replaced the pre-modern agrarian societies of the pre-industrial age. The degree of industrialization of any society now is considered as an important indicator of its economic development. As discussed, both modernization and convergence theory in a way put forward that industrialization will lead to emergence of global culture. And no matter what is the nature of social, economic, political structure of any society, they will ultimately converge. The empirical reality shows that this is true to a large extent, but it is not always the case. There are many parallels and contrasts between the experience of industrialization in India and the Western model of industrialization. Comparative analysis of different countries like developed, developing and underdeveloped nations shows that there is no standard model of industrialization or economic development. As a negation of modernization and convergence thesis, development or industrialization of any society is dependent upon or is determined by the nature and character of social, political and economic institutions and the prevailing set of values and culture of that society. Thus, they are important actors and factors that act both as 1. Cause and consequence and 2. Facilitate and complicate the economic development of society. There are 2 important concepts to be discussed here. One is economic development and the other one is economic growth. Economic growth and development are often used interchangeably, but they are not the same. Economic growth is one aspect of economic development. Let us understand the difference between these 2 concepts. Let's begin by economic growth. Economic growth is concerned with increase in the economy's output. It is a measure of the value of output of goods and services within a given period of time in a country. It brings quantitative changes in the economy as it refers to an increase in the real output of goods and services like increase in the real income. On the other hand, economic development refers to structural changes in the economy. It relates to the growth of human development index, such as decrease in inequality, institutional and structural changes that improve welfare and quality of life of people in society over a long period of time. Development brings both qualitative and quantitative changes in the economy. There are various indicators used to assess the status of economic development of a country or at what stage industrialization has reached. Some of the important economic indicators are, first, GDP, which means the gross domestic product. It is value of output produced within a country within a given period of time. GDP per capita is distribution of GDP per head taking into account the size of the population. GNI, which is gross national income. It is the total value of goods and services produced within a country together with the balance of income and payments from or to the other countries. And we also take real GDP into account, which accounts for differences in price levels of different countries. Along with these indicators, some other important indicators of economic development are per capita gross national product. Second, development of infrastructure, which includes industrialization and also urbanization and growth and development of cities and urban areas. It also includes occupational structure of the labor force, that is, how many people are engaged in which sector of the economy, namely primary, secondary or tertiary sector. It also includes growth of population, per capita consumption and other social indicators. The social indicators we can discuss are rate of literacy, life expectancy, infant mortality, calorie intake, access to healthcare and educational facilities, and achieving equality in society. In sum, The economic development involves higher incomes, better education, higher standards of health and nutrition, less poverty, a cleaner environment, equality of opportunities, greater individual freedom, and a rich cultural life for people in a given country. Most of the developed countries show high rating on these indices. All the indicators of economic development can be divided into economic factors of development and non-economic factors of development. Briefly stating, the economic factors of development include capital, labor, availability and exploitation of natural resources, level of technology and industrialization, nature and certainty of markets, including labor market and financial markets. On the other hand, the non-economic factors of development include attitude towards work and life, integrity of government agencies, such as level of corruption, cultural tradition, property rights, institutional and social values, adherence to ethical norms, etc. Let us discuss some of these factors here in detail. To begin with, let us take into account the differences relating to what kind of work people are engaged in economy. Economists often make a distinction between various sectors of economy, namely primary sector, secondary sector, and tertiary sector. They also make a distinction between public and private sector. Apart from this, we can also differentiate between organized, that is formal, and unorganized, that is informal sector of economy. Let us look at the difference between the three sectors of economy, the basic sectors, primary, secondary, and tertiary. In the primary sector, we produce a commodity by exploiting natural resources. Activities associated with the primary sector include agriculture, both subsistence and commercial agriculture. It includes mining, forestry, farming, grazing, hunting and gathering, and fishing. At times, the packaging and processing of the raw material associated with this sector is also considered to be part of primary sector. This sector is also called as agricultural sector. The secondary sector of economy manufactures finished goods. Manufacturing, processing, and construction is part of the secondary sector. It covers activities in which natural products are changed into semi-finished or finished form through manufacturing that we associate with industrial activity. It is the next step after the primary sector. The product is not natural, but it is made by humans involving some labor or process of manufacturing. Other than these two sectors, the tertiary sector of the economy is the service sector. This sector provides services to the general population and to the businesses. Activities associated with this sector include retail, wholesale, distribution, transportation, media, entertainment, which includes cinema, television, radio, music, theater, business process outsourcing, restaurants, tourism industry, insurance, banking, healthcare, and legal services. In most developed and developing countries, a majority of people work in the tertiary sector. For instance, in the United States of America, more than 80% of the labor force works in the tertiary sector. Statistics reveal that in developed countries, the majority of people are in services sector, followed by industry, manufacturing, or the secondary sector, and less than 10% people are engaged in primary or agricultural sector. If we look at the data or contribution of these sectors in Indian economy, the share of agriculture is progressively declining and services are now contributing approximately half of the total GDP. In India, agriculture and allied activities accounted for 14.5% of total GDP in 2010-11 as compared to 14.7% in the year 2009-10. Notwithstanding the declining trend in agriculture share in GDP, it is critical from the income distribution perspective, as this sector accounted for about 58% employment in the country according to the census of 2001. This is a very serious situation because it means that the sector which provides employment to maximum number of people is not able to generate much income for them. Employment in the industrial sector increased from 64.6 million persons in 1999 to 2000 to 100.7 million people in 2009-10. The share of industry in total employment increased from 16.2% in 1999 year 2000 to 21.9% in 2009-10. The services sector is the principal source of employment in urban areas. As already discussed, the share of the service sector in GDP is progressing. The services sector accounted for 147 people per 1,000 employed in rural areas and 582 people per 1,000 in urban areas. The services sector provides employment to 23% of the workforce and is growing quickly, with a growth rate of 7.5% in 1991 to year 2000, which is up from 4.5% in 1951 to 1980. It has the largest share in the GDP now, accounting for 55% in 2007, and this was merely 15% after independence in the year 1951. Another difference between developing and developed countries can be measured in terms of the number of people in regular salaried employment. In developed countries, greater percentage of people are formally employed, or they are employed in formal sectors or organized sector of economy. In India, over 50% of population is self-employed. Only 14% people are in regular salaried employment or in the organized sector, while approximately 30% work as casual labor. An important aspect of economic development is measured in terms of achievement of equality in society. Let us briefly discuss about the issue of gender equality or inequality in economic sphere. Although equality in general means any kind of equality, be it social, cultural, ethnic, linguistic. But let us discuss gender equality within this context. Statistics reveal that women do 2/3 of the world's work, but they earn just 10% of world's income. And unfortunately, they own only 1% of world's property. Women earn less than men. They are more likely to be employed in temporary or casual work. If we look at the structure of the workforce and employment patterns, we'll find gender-based segregation. Women have always worked both within and outside of their homes. However, they suffer from both vertical and horizontal segregation in labor markets and workplace. There is enough evidence to support that women are not paid as much as men across a range of professions and occupations. And even if they do the same job as their male counterparts, the chances of their promotion and upward mobility in organizational hierarchy are less. This phenomena is called as glass ceiling, which means that women can rise only up to a certain level in the organizational hierarchy, beyond which certain social and cultural factors play an important role and keep them under the position. In general, women are underrepresented in the workforce, but they are concentrated in the lower status and low-paid job. Such employment patterns can be explained in terms of stereotyping of occupations and professions into masculine and feminine work or professions. Women are considered more suitable for jobs such as nursing, school teacher, secretarial services, receptionist, etc., than in other sectors like engineering. While men are considered as robust, physically strong, and take up professions that are generally considered to be masculine, such as doctors, engineers, lawyers, defense personnel, etc. Is it just a coincidence, or is it because society thinks that women are more suitable for caring and nurturing kind of work as compared to jobs which are tough or seen as masculine? Based upon the gender stereotypes, there is a gender distinction between the jobs that men and women traditionally go for. To conclude, let us summarize what we discussed in this lecture. We started discussing the difference between economic growth and economic development. We discussed about economic and non-economic indicators of development. We also discussed about different sectors of economy, that is primary, secondary, and tertiary, and their percentage of GDP and employment in these sectors in India. Towards the end of this lecture, we discussed about the gender segregation in workforce. In the next lecture, we'll continue with industrialization in India since independence. Till then, you can enjoy reading this part of the chapter. Thank you.